Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, whatever it is, the time, wherever you are and you're watching this. Today, I want to talk to you about a very different type of therapy. As people exposed to counseling, practicing counseling, or having understood counseling, most of you at least, you know that there are different types of therapies which people use. There are the talking therapies and there are the other therapies. The other therapies are what? They are things like NLP or Reiki or any of those where no talking is involved, but certain techniques are used in order to, you know, get healing of the mind. Then, of course, we have the talking therapies, which is what we generally refer to as counseling. But then there are specific therapies, no? There are people who use the basic of, Sigmund Freud's psychoanalysis. Then you have Adler's therapy. Then you have so many others, Gestalt's. These are all talking therapies. Other than all these non-talking and talking therapies, today I just wanted to introduce the concept to you and discuss with you of the concept of nature as therapy. Can nature be a therapy? That is, therapy, of course, is healing, healing of the mind. So, can nature be used in terms of healing of the mind, making you feel happier, making you feel serene or comfortable, or enhancing your motivation and your optimism and stuff like that? That is what I was thinking since a very, very long time. Then I condensed a lot of stuff and I thought, come on, let me, you know, discuss it with you this today. Now, other than all the therapies and all that that have come, there are some more which are not actually used so much as therapy, but they do help in the healing process. Take storytelling, for example, in children. If there is a good storyteller who makes a child or a number of children sit down and starts talking to them with the right intonations and with the right way of conveying the story, children get mesmerized. They get fascinated with it. And if they were crying or they were upset about something or they were feeling low, automatically their mood improves. Same thing happens with music. Those of us, you know, who like music, if you are feeling bad, if you're feeling dull, and you put on some nice, pleasing music, the one which you like, you automatically see that your mood improves. You feel a little more optimistic towards life. Your depression lifts. So like that, there are so many of them. Now today, as I said, we are going to talk about nature as a therapy. What do I mean by that? It's something very, very basic and fundamental of, number one, being with nature. The more I spend time with nature, whether you understand that significance or not, it does play a role of healing. Why is it that most of us city people, when we want to take a break, we prefer going into the nature? Because we live in a concrete jungle. We are in cooped up spaces. We are in an artificial environment of concrete and roads and tall buildings and whatever it is. So the moment we move out from this concrete jungle and go into a real jungle, a natural jungle, we immediately feel a sense of serenity, of peace. And if we spend time with nature on a regular basis, it is equivalent to going to your therapist on a regular basis. So if I'm upset about something, what do? I identify a good therapist, counselor. I go there. I speak to him or her. I find, yes, I felt nice after talking. So what should I do? I should go and have regular sessions. So every now and then when I'm meeting my therapist and talking it out, I start feeling good. And on a long-term basis, the healing takes place. Now, nature by itself can actually be a good therapist. How and why is that? Let's start with understanding the basic concept that we are all part of nature. What we have done in the artificial sense, that is, constructing buildings with four walls and a roof, all made by concrete or artificial stuff. Few generations back, our ancestors, even when they built a house, it used to be made of wood and straw and thatched roofs and stuff like that, right? So they were still close to nature. What have we done? We have moved away into this artificial things. Our ancestors used to sit on the ground. The lady of the house would be cooking something on fire, and maybe she makes some hot chapati or something. She would start handing it over. If there are six people sitting, one by one, everybody would get a chapati and they would be eating, sitting in a cross-legged position on the ground. Today, we sit on chairs and put our plates on a table, and the food is already there served. We scoop out whatever we want and we eat. Many of us do spend time with our family or loved ones while eating. So that again is a good therapy. But there are also people who will be eating with the mobile phone stuck to their ear. And when daddy puts that mobile phone, the child also pulls out his phone and starts playing a game with one hand and eating with the other hand. Now, all these things are artificial. They are not natural. They are not part of nature. And when that happens, we are going further and further and further away from nature. So what is it that we are losing out on, and what is it that we can gain if we decide to be part of nature? I think the first and most important thing is that nature teaches us delayed gratification. This year itself, most of India went through a blistering summer. For months together, the temperatures were very high and there was no rain. But even the richest man could not generate rain. Yes, he could sit in his air-conditioned room, but that also is artificial, no? And when he steps out of his air-conditioned room, what happens to him? The blast hits him so strongly, he cannot tolerate the heat and he falls sick. So that way, if you acknowledge that the more we are closer to nature, we learn delayed gratification. You say, no, the IMD has announced that monsoon will hit peninsular India around first week of June. There is no way, nothing that you can do to make it come faster. And that brings us down to earth, where we have got so used to getting things because of our money power or status. Nature does not identify, does not recognize how rich you are, how powerful you are. Everybody has to go through the same thing. The other thing is that when you are with nature, you are getting fresh air, oxygen, plenty of oxygen. You're not getting polluted air. You're not getting polluted water. You're getting everything which is pristine, which is unadulterated. And when you get that, your health improves and your mental health also improves. Nature helps us to appreciate, acknowledge the good things. If a long summer was not there, we would not be able to enjoy the monsoon when it comes. After days and weeks and months of heat, the day the clouds gather and it starts raining, it gives you a joy which nothing else can give you. And that is because we are part of nature. The changes in the climate. Even in monsoon, for example, suddenly you're enjoying the monsoon, temperatures have come down, everything is going fine. Then suddenly one day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, the temperature starts going up. Hey, this is supposed to be monsoon. How come the temperature is going up so much? How come there's no rain? Can you do anything about it? Can you use political influence to get rain? Can you throw money and get rain? No. If it is not going to rain for X days, it is not going to rain for X days. It brings you down to earth to understand that you cannot control your life and you cannot control your environment. The other thing is that whenever you are with nature, check it out when you go out next time and are with nature. All limbs and all parts of your body get exercise, which doesn't happen when you're sitting here in the concrete jungle. And when we are amidst nature, we become aware of the fact that we are a tiny speck in the universe. Sit on a cloudless night on a terrace and watch the sky. You see millions of stars, particularly if it's a moonless night. You see millions of stars. And we are told that each star is 100 times, 1,000 times, or 10,000 times bigger than Earth. And there are millions of them happily floating around in the universe. And we are part of one solar system in which we are one planet, in which we are one country and one city and one building. So what are we? It brings us down to humility if you appreciate and spend time amidst nature. We learn to accept diversity, differences. This is different, that is different. We cannot change it. We cannot do anything about what nature is doing. We cannot command it. If nature gets angry, nature can even send you a tsunami or an earthquake. You have to accept it. There may be buildings which are made spending millions. Even those buildings collapse if there is an earthquake. You may be having buildings which are 30 floors high, but at the ground level, if there is flooding, you can't enter and you cannot leave the building. So these are the things which we get. And if we start accepting these things, including injury, death, vulnerability, the more we start accepting these things, the more we are with nature, the more our mind heals for any issues, any problems that we may be facing. When you're amidst nature, you learn the value of animals, all creatures who are wild and free. They are not dependent on you in any way. If you don't go out there and kill them, they live happily. They have lived for millions of years. They'll continue living for millions of years. Nature also gives us a lot of, you know, medicinal plants. Three generations back, we used to have a village vaidya who never bought medicine from a manufacturer. He would go around and collect leaves, roots, bark, whatever fruits, and he knew how to convert them into medicine. So whatever was available in nature around us, they used to take that and be happy with the thing. We also learn the connection between the mind and the body. Also the way the body heals itself. Wild animals or even street dogs, they have an injury, they get into a fight or they have an accident. You'll see a horrible wound. Literally, their body has been torn apart. You think this one is going to die because this one is not going to any doctor. Few days later, you'll be surprised to see the same fellow running around happily, his wound having healed without having taken any medicines, without any surgery. And this is something which is so valuable to us, and we are, you know, losing out on that. So let's see, once long back in Manthan, I had one of my colleagues had shot a video, a small one. Just have a look and you will understand what I have said so far, and you will appreciate the value of nature.
Exists all around us. In fact, nature is the being, and we are these tiny little components of nature. And here we are, you can see, just have a look at this, you know, calm and serene video. Look at that little anthill under the tree. How many brains of ants must have got into it to construct this huge anthill? So many architects, city planners, civil engineers, masons must have gone into it. The same with those birds who build nests on the trees. The same with the flowers that blossom, and then their pollen is taken by somebody and transferred somewhere else. And you see this tiny creature once more. He knows exactly what life is all about.
Yes, just a short clip which we shot at Manthan, right here, almost within the city. Now you go another 50 miles out and you will see wonderful things happening. But the question is, are we open to it? See, many of us have chosen to live in big cities because of livelihood, because of, let's say, medical facilities available, or because of good education for our child. Whatever may be the reasons that you are living in a huge concrete jungle, don't isolate yourself from nature. Whenever you get time, whenever you get out of your city, you know, don't go to Singapore or New York or Delhi or other metropolitan areas. Go amidst nature and see what nature has to give you. Focus individually on every aspect of nature. Look at everything one at a time. One simple thing at a time. You can have a look at that. And when you see something, like I showed you that big ant scampering around, if you have the time and patience, can you sit and observe where that ant came from and where is it going? And what is its purpose of today? All nature, other than human beings, live one day at a time. Even the most ferocious animal, he is hungry, he stalks, he goes towards his prey, somehow manages to catch hold of it, kill it, tear it open, feed himself with it. afterwards, whatever is left over, he is not bothered. Let the hyenas and foxes and all of them come and eat right in front of him. He doesn't disturb him. He doesn't wonder, where will I get my food next day? He doesn't have a deep freeze to put this and then tomorrow I can take it out and microwave it and eat it again. No. He lives one day at a time. To at least some extent, can we start doing that? This is something which, you know, I have been researching and learning on this concept of mindfulness. I had a wonderful workshop on mindfulness. I really enjoyed it. And thankfully, many of the participants said that they enjoyed it. So they've asked for one more. On 6th of July, I'm doing a half-day workshop on mindfulness. But why I brought it up is because mindfulness is another way of connecting with nature, of giving up all sorts of regrets and worries about the past, of giving up anxiety about the future, which, like I said, no other being, neither that ant nor that tiger nor any other creature, is worried about what is going to happen tomorrow. If we can learn these lessons, and we can learn these lessons only if we spend time amidst nature. If we do that, there is so much to learn from every aspect of nature. It could be domesticated animals. It could be wilder animals. It could be birds. It could be insects. It could be the clouds or the sea or the greenery or the rivers or the waterfalls. Every one of these things has something to teach us, provided we are open to learning from them. If I get stuck with my ego and I say that I am superior to all these beings, I am the great human being, what can they teach me? I am headed for my own destruction. A simple thing like, do you still remember or have you forgotten COVID, Corona? Life came to a standstill. The most powerful and the richest people could not go out. And they sat in their homes shivering, wondering whether I will catch that virus, whether I will die or my loved one will die. What a lesson it should have been to us. But unfortunately, it wasn't. We still didn't learn that lesson. The moment everything is lifted and we feel there is no danger, we have happily gone around again taking advantage of nature. In fact, one of my students, Dr. Veda, you know, who is a medical practitioner and a pathologist, she has written a very, very good book on this, how this corona spread, why it spread, how we are responsible for the spread of these viruses like COVID, which can literally put life onto a halt, not just in one house, one locality, or one city, not just in one country, the entire world came to a standstill. There could have been no better lesson learned if we were open to the lesson. But all that we were aware of or concerned about is, will I get corona or not? Will my loved ones get corona or not? Nobody thought of what is happening, and it did happen. During the corona period, there were two occasions when I went off into remote areas, into villages. It was as though corona didn't exist. There was no lockdown, there were no face masks, nothing was there. People were going around with their own work. They turned out to be wiser and superior to us. And that is up to us to learn. How and where we can do it? Oh, there are a number of places. If you just look around, you will find innumerable places around you. Maybe it'll take you a little distance. You'll have to book a train ride or get a bus or go in your own vehicle or whatever it is. But it is possible to get away. So we just shortlisted. Have a look at a few of these slides to see which are the possible areas where you can go if you want to get away from the concrete jungle and connect to nature. So here it is, some of the benefits of being close to nature and using its healing powers. Let us see. you get delayed gratification. I mentioned that to you. Fresh air, more oxygen to the brain. Appreciating, accepting change of climates. Exercising the whole body. I'm just reminding you of all these things so that I want you to please make a mental note of this. Awareness of what a small part of the universe we are. Look up at the sky and you will be overwhelmed. Adapting to diversity and differences. All types of differences. See how animals and birds live in diversity. Accepting injury, death, vulnerability. Learning basic values from animals, like they do not kill except for food, except that they are hungry only they do, otherwise they never kill other animals. Using medicinal plants, as I mentioned to you, there is so much. We have forgotten it. We have given up on it and gone into chemicals. Chemical medicines are far more harmful than natural medicines. Learning that the body and mind heals itself. I gave the example of, you know, stray dogs and such animals. Now, let us see. What are the type of places that you can go to get away? The variety is so much. Sonal has clicked a few nice photographs for us. Here is a beautiful boathouse in the backwaters of Kerala. The boat is going through its serene thing. Here are the hills where they have plantations. And you see those mud roads. And you see the green everywhere around. Of course, this is there only in limited parts of our country. But yes, it is very much there. There are places in India where you have snowfall, where you have giant mountains on the foothills of Himalayas and all that. There are these hill stations all over the country. We have beautiful hill stations, which are green, serene. The reverse of that, we have wonderful deserts, if you could go and look at it. Maybe in Rajasthan, maybe in Kutch, in different places. You can see what life is without greenery. And we come back to the seashore. There you have these fishermen, their boats. You see a lot of coconut trees behind you. You see the small huts in which the villagers live and lead their life. They understand how to take care of nature and to dream with it. If we can make these efforts, at least once in a while, if not on a regular basis, there are so many places right in our own country. You don't have to go all over. Very often I keep hearing people when I say that if you had no restrictions, what would you like to do? They say, go on a world tour. I would say, don't waste your time and money and energy on going on a world tour. Go on a tour within the four corners of India and you will see such wonderful things, such variations from snow-capped mountains to the deserts, to the seaside, to the backwaters, to the hill stations, you name it and we have it. It's up to us. And don't just go there. I know people who go on vacations, put on the TV in their hotel or resort and sit watching TV. Isn't it a criminal waste? If you have gone out beyond the concrete jungle, there is so much to learn. Use it as a fun-loving time where you can look around, poke around and learn about anything and everything which your textbooks, your schools and colleges, your teachers cannot give you. And that is what enhances your life skills. And it heals it actually heals. Next time, if you are very upset about something and you are feeling down and out, use nature as a therapy. Just somehow take time off, get away, and go amidst nature. Start observing, start analyzing, start trying to understand what nature is all about. And you will see your horizons will widen, your learning will improve, your mood will improve, and you will learn that nature can be a wonderful therapy. That is my simple message to you. Please practice it. Please go around looking for opportunities to do it. But right now, I'm going to take my 1 minute break, and Purni is here to update you on what is happening.
Hi. Good afternoon. How are you all? Yeah, I'm seeing a lot of comments, coffee estates and hill stations and good afternoons and so many things. I was just listening to Ali and then I realized from Banjara we had been to Himachal Pradesh for a program with the Tibetans. Hi there, with the Tibetans. And the mountain ranges, you feel so choto, you know. We were not even near the big mountain ranges, okay. We were just at the foothills there and the big ones were a little away. But even from the place where we were, we looked so small and the ranges were like mind-blowing. You know, that taught us so much, you know, that nature teaches us to be humble, to be modest. You know, it was a fantastic experience we had. And once I was watching this thing, some serial documentary on TV. This was quite some time back. And there, there was this tiger which was bitten by a venomous snake. Okay. And what it did was it just went into being a recluse for a week. And there was this National Geographic thing which was, you know, being shot. And after a week, the tiger came back healing itself on its own through some natural thing. How fantastic it is, you know, to do that. Yeah, we too can learn to respond positively to those things that get under our skin. I totally true that, Surekha. And we can create a beautiful pearl every time we face difficulties. We come out more stronger. Hi, Kumar. And in fact, I'll also tell you, there are so many things happening at Banjara. We are full of action. We are full of lot of nice things, either for you or for people who you may know. Okay. So I'll ask Anish to quickly show us the activities and the action that's happening at Banjara. You must be knowing, right? Our online course. See, we have an online course which is on certificate in child and adolescent development. So this takes you from pregnancy till adolescence. All the things that come in between this zero or even minus age, that is through the pregnancy till 18 years of age. It's an online course. It is actually a very well accepted course and comes in handy for anyone who needs to deal with children. So we are very shortly going to close that, the admissions. If you know anyone, please ask them to immediately call up office, teachers, parents, caregivers, caretakers, anyone who deals with children, grandparents, uncles, aunties, nieces, nephews, nannies, governesses, whoever be it, who will benefit by understanding the nuances of the 21st century child. Okay. So the children need a little different kind of dealing and managing. No? And then on 29th of June, we are having our inauguration of the 26th batch of DCS. So fondly known as DCS, but it is Diploma in Counseling Skills. So that is happening in the afternoon from 2:30 to 5:30. In the morning, what we are having is a counseling workshop, which is going to be a 3 hours workshop. This is going to serve many purposes. One is people still are, you know, under that, okay, myth, what is counseling? Is it for me? Is it not for me? Is it for people who have done their psychology? Is it for, you know, so many ifs and buts come into their mind. So this workshop will demystify, you know, all the clarifications that they need. And for those who also want to, you know, contemplate whether I can have 1 year to do the diploma course, and then, you know, this will really help them to understand that, hey, yeah, I think it's not all that difficult. I may be able to take an informed decision. So we want to give that opportunity to those who want to contemplate, who want to understand what counseling is. And of course, in the evening is our inauguration. And then we had a very successful workshop on mindfulness. So Ali steered it. It's a very intense kind of a 3 hour workshop, which was conducted, very well accepted. We had around 40, 45 participants. And on more requests, we are having once again mindfulness workshop on 6th of July. So these are the few things which are coming up. And inform anyone who can benefit. That's what we said. If you think you would like to come, be a little more mindful, drop in at the academy. And Roshan and Surekha have already started typing their comments. So your comments, compliments, thoughts, opinions, questions, all in the second half of the break. So over to Ali.
Yes, I'm back. Weather is getting a little hot, but still tolerable. So let's see. Start with Renu, who says, change in climate changes our moods. Yes. But you know, Renu and others, there is also a quote which says, there are people who create their own weather. And that was also brought out very well in a song of that absolutely fabulous movie, Three Idiots. I leave it to you. Look back, hear the songs, and see what message was conveyed about a person who creates his own weather. And that is what we can do if we understand nature to the fullest extent. Ah, Rishi Jain says, hill stations. Of course, hill stations are my favorite. If you ask me, I would rather go to a hill station than anywhere else whenever I take. Even if I can't go to huge, far away, big hill stations, I don't mind going up to Nandi Hills also, if it is not too crowded. Veena says, coffee estates. Yes, that's another good thing. And nowadays, a lot of coffee estates are opening up for visitors and guests. And you can go there and spend a few days there with them. So that's a great advantage. That's one more option for you. Okay, so Roshan says, my friend who has moved away from Hyderabad and built a beautiful house in Coorg is tremendously improving in health. Fresh, unpolluted or poor spring water has done the trick of keeping her in good health. Exactly. It takes a lot of courage to actually move out and go to, you know, a place like Coorg or anywhere else which is away from the concrete jungle. But as I said, for those who cannot take that plunge and move away from cities, at least visit such places. Try to create as much time. Nowadays we have these workathons also. You can take your laptop, go there and catch up with the work also. It's not that you have to lose out or you have to take leave for a long time, right? Okay, Sunita says, forest bathing. Yes, that's another wonderful thing. Forests are such lovely places, no? Unpolluted nature. Surekha says, just as an oyster creates a pearl from the painful grain of sand that gets under its skin, we too can learn to respond positively to those things that get under our skin. In this way, we can create a beautiful pearl every time we face difficulties. Beautifully said, Surekha. No poet would have been able to express it the way you have done. And Surekha also gave us a wonderful vacation, which I will remember for a long time to come, completely amidst nature. Surekha also says, the other day I was looking at the calm, deep lake of Ramohalli. Sometime later, the surface got disturbed by the storm and the violent winds, but the depth remained untouched. Yes, this was a beautiful metaphor for our internal power that can remain unshaken by the storms and hurricanes of the external world. And this lesson you can learn only if you are there sitting next to the lake, observing, understanding, and analyzing. Roshan says, I live in a one-year-old house in the heart of Secunderabad city. Yet, we are very happy as we have a lovely garden where I have started growing vegetables and herbal plants. I truly believe that nature has the power to heal. We were taught in pranic healing that if one is depressed, go around a tree several times and hug it to give you the energy and make you bounce back. Wonderful example, no? And there are so many such options to it. There are so many animals, there are so many birds, there are so many trees which give you that serenity and that feeling that life is genuinely worth it. Gives a meaning to your life. Surekha says, every day the grass at Lalbagh is a positive motivator and has inspired my behavior. Even though it is stepped upon, crushed, burnt or cut, it always persists and grows back even more greener and stronger. We too need to strive to bounce back from our trials and traumas to reach higher levels of strength and competence. Now, here is a beautiful example. Lalbagh is right in the heart of the city. Even if you're not staying very close to it, get into your vehicle or an auto or a cab and just go down there in a few minutes and spend time there. Beautiful hundreds of acres of nature right in the heart of the city. That way, as Bangaloreans, we are very lucky. We have Kabban Park on this side. We have Lalbagh on the other side. We have so many things. You don't even have to go miles and miles looking for nature. And I'm sure that is there in so many other cities also. If you look around at identify places, there you can spend time. Sarayu says, we learn art of giving without any expectation from nature. Very true. Only nature can teach us that lesson, you know. Long back, I remember in my childhood, we used to recite a poem which says, Nadiya na piye kabhi apna jal, vriksh na khaye kabhi apne phal. No tree eats its own fruit and no river drinks its own water. So what is the lesson from there? Surekha says, during my visit to the Nagarhole forest, I learned that when a tree dies, it lies on the earth's surface and all is not over. As the years go by, the tree decomposes and blends into the soil, returning all that it took so that others may live. And the same is true of us. When we die and lie on the earth's surface, we too will blend into the soil, returning all that we had taken so that others may live. At least in the end, we are going to have to give something. Then why not now? Why not live fully today rather than giving back once we are no more? Food for thought. Avinita says, Ali, I'm in Delhi right now. It's actually around 49, 50 degrees, but trying to stay positive and doing things indoor. Yes, Vinit, I appreciate that. And as long as you're not running away from what nature is giving you, while 50 degrees is intense heat, also remember it is adding to your vitamin D. It is adding to your health in so many ways. Those who shut themselves up in air-conditioned rooms will never get the benefits of nature. Yes, I'm not saying you should go out in the hot sun and all that. Go out early morning, late evening. In the meanwhile, stay at home. But learn to have natural ways of keeping cool. Mamta says, as the topic discussed, I realize the value of Mother Nature during pandemic, during second phase in 2021, April, May, where the hospitals were short of oxygen cylinders and many people suffered due to oxygen dip in body and lack of cylinder in hospitals. This is a lesson mankind learned the value of tree, which produces enormous free oxygen. And we living in urban cities should save a tree and Mother Nature. I'm blessed to have a beautiful park in front of my house where I go for a walk, etc. This is what I'm saying. Mamta has brought out so beautifully. Oxygen is plentifully available. Trees are breathing out oxygen every day for us. And what are we doing? We are cutting off those trees. And when we need oxygen, we have to set up a manufacturing plant and then bottle that oxygen into cylinders and rush them to hospitals. See the pathetic situation that we have created for ourselves. No other living being needs to look around and hunt for oxygen or buy oxygen. They get it naturally, and we can also get it. Sridevi says, awesome parks are there in Bangalore, sir. We are so lucky, I feel. Very true. That's one thing that I appreciate about Bangalore, where the others may talk only about traffic jams and this and that. But Bangalore still has, Artinagar, where I stay, has got four parks. Can you believe that? One locality has got four parks. All four of them are well maintained. All of them are green. Some of them even have play equipment for children to come and play free of cost. The most ordinary human being can come there and spend time. I'm very thankful to the BBMP that now they have increased the timing of the parks also. So the parks are going to be open the whole day and right up to 10 o'clock in the night. But I'm one person who likes to have a walk after dinner. Sometimes if my dinner is late, the parks will close down. Now I'm going to have the privilege of taking at least a short stroll, if not a walk, after dinner. And again, I missed greenery in the park. Okay, nature, Roshan says, nature keeps giving all the time and we are trying to chop trees to build concrete jungles. We are suffering due to global warming. When we are against nature, nature will turn against us. Nature is already turning against us, giving out signals. A tsunami comes, hundreds of people die, houses are flattened, so much damage takes place, but we don't learn a lesson. The beauty of it is, it has been recorded that whenever there is a tsunami or an earthquake, the animals sense it. The animals start running away from there, birds start flying away. Even domestic animals want to break their shackles and run away from there. And as human beings, with all our technology and all that, we are watching and seeing what's wrong with these animals. Why are they creating such a racket? Nothing is happening. And hours later, the tsunami or the earthquake strikes. So who are the people with greater wisdom? Ask yourself that. Sridevi also says, I decided to donate some of my fees as a freelancer to the plant, the trees and sort, and stated the same in my Google account from where my clients come now. So wonderful, Sridevi. That's a great gesture. If you can share whatever your income, your wealth, your assets with nature, nothing like it. If we can nurture animals, birds, trees, flowers, we can be part of them. Okay. Roshan says, we live in a century old house, not 1 year old. Sorry for the error. Doesn't make a difference whether it's 1 year old or 100 year old. The type of lifestyle that you are dealing with is more important. Wonderful. I've come across such very, very positive, very thought-provoking comments from each one of you. It gives me the spirit that when I interact with you all, I get to learn so much and my spirits go up. My weekend definitely goes beautifully after this Saturday afternoon session. And on Monday, I'm back into my routine, enjoying myself, going for walks, admiring plants, stopping to smell the flowers, and whenever possible, going out into nature and spending some wonderful time there. Even if I cannot physically move out permanently from a big city, at least I can start spending, and I am spending, and that's what I request each and every one of you to do. Please do that. So that completes my session. I'm very thankful that so many of you keep coming week after week, contributing so much to the happenings and the knowledge of these sessions. I look forward every week, and the next week's topic is here. Anis is showing you. It is on boredom. Why do we feel bored? And how can we overcome when we feel bored? Ask yourself. If you have bouts when you say, I'm bored, I have nothing to do, I'm not feeling good, remember that boredom is created internally by us, not by external factors. And there are wonderful ways of overcoming boredom whenever it hits you. And that is what we will discuss next Saturday on 22nd June. At this point, let me also tell you that the week after that, 29th, we will be taking a break because we've got two sessions. As Purni told you in the morning, we are having a lovely workshop on what is counseling, the overview or, you know, the basics of counseling for people who are not aware of what is counseling, a three-hour workshop. Afternoon, we are inaugurating our new batch of DCS students. If you know anybody who wants to join, they've got 2 weeks ahead. Let them get in touch with us. But regardless of what happens, I thoroughly enjoy these sessions and my interactions with each of you individually and collectively. So I bid you bye-bye till next Saturday.
Nature exists all around us. In fact, nature is the being, and we are these tiny little components of nature. And here we are, you can see, just have a look at this, you know, calm and serene video. Look at that little anthill under the tree. How many brains of ants must have got into it to construct this huge anthill? So many architects, city planners, civil engineers, masons must have gone into it. The same with those birds who build nests on the trees. The same with the flowers that blossom, and then their pollen is taken by somebody and transferred somewhere else. And you see this tiny creature once more. He knows exactly what life is all about.